My name is Gurdeep Pandher and I dance Bhangra in this beautiful Yukon wilderness. And I'm sending you joy, hope and positivity. It is my pleasure to welcome you to 2021 Fellows Show.
Welcome to the Royal Canadian Geographical Society's 2021 Fellows Show. My name is Aliya Jasmine, and as your host for the evening, it is my pleasure to thank you for joining us in celebration of Canada and its amazing geography, and on Geographic Information Systems Day, no less. Happy Geography Awareness Week to everyone. Bienvenue au Fellows Show 2021 de la Société Géographique Royale du Canada. Mon nom est Aliya Jasmine. Et à titre d'animatrice pour la soirée, je vous remercie de vous joindre à nous pour célébrer le Canada et son incroyable géographie. Je vous souhaite une joyeuse semaine de l'éveil à la géographie. Thank you to Honorary Fellow and 2021 Louis Kamukak Medal winner Gurdeep Pandher for that uplifting performance from his home near Lake Leberge, Yukon, that started this show. I am hosting this evening from the Society's headquarters at 50 Sussex Drive in Ottawa, Canada's Centre for Geography and Exploration, on the unceded territory of the Algonquin peoples. And we further acknowledge and recognize that the Society's work reaches across all of the distinct First Nations, Métis homelands, and Inuit Nunangat, and for this, we are grateful. I am very glad to be hosting from Canada's Centre for Geography and Exploration, and throughout the show, I'll be joining you from a number of the amazing spaces throughout this building. Now, before we get too far into tonight's show, we have a message from an incredibly special guest this evening. Please welcome Society Chief Executive Officer John Geiger to introduce this amazing VIP. Maintenant, pendant que la soirée est encore jeune, nous avons un message pour vous de la part d'une invitée très spéciale. Veuillez accueillir John Geiger, chef de la direction, pour vous présenter cette personne incroyable.
Thank you, Aliya. We are absolutely delighted to have you hosting the Fellows Show again this year. While it is unfortunate we couldn't see you all in person, we're certain we'll all be able to gather in Ottawa in November 2022 for the Society's biggest gala yet. We have 2 years to make up for. As you know, we typically gather at this time each year for our College of Fellows annual dinner. It is an opportunity to reconnect with old friends and colleagues. It is also a chance to reflect on the incredible growth of the Society and how each of us, as part of the RCGS community, has contributed to it. While we're all intrepid explorers, the COVID pandemic has again stopped us from gathering in person, but not from celebrating the Society. And so, we still have an unforgettable evening planned. How unforgettable? You almost won't believe who our next very special message is from. I was grateful to be her guest, along with fellow Deborah Apps, at St. James's Palace in May 2019 to welcome her to the Society as an Honorary Fellow. It is a true privilege to introduce tonight Her Royal Highness, the Princess Royal.
It is a pleasure to join the Royal Canadian Geographical Society for this special virtual Fellows Show. I'm delighted to be an Honorary Fellow of the Society and to receive my Fellows Neck Badge and a copy of the excellent book, Canadian Geographic Indigenous Peoples Atlas of Canada, from your Chief Executive Officer, John Geiger, in May 2019 at St. James's Palace. In addition to my association with your Society, I am also patron of the Royal Geographical Society and Vice President of the Royal Scottish Geographical Society. I am encouraged by the close bonds these two organizations have developed with you in recent years. Collaboration amongst those of us who are interested in the world's peoples, landscapes, and wildlife is as important today as ever, as our planet increasingly becomes one global community. Your society will celebrate the 65th anniversary of the addition of Royal to its title in 2022. This was due to the efforts of Governor General Vincent Massey in 1957, who was patron of the Society at the time. Even before that, the Society enjoyed strong ties with the Canadian Crown. In 1929, Viscount Willingdon became the first in a continuous patronage from the incumbent Governor General. 17 consecutive Governor Generals have served as patron. I have visited Canada on more than 20 occasions, both official and private, from Haines Junction, Yukon, to Red Bay, Labrador, and many other places. One of the most memorable was as a member of the British equestrian team at the 1976 Montreal Olympic Games, although that was a rather different perspective. Accompanying Her Majesty and the Duke of Edinburgh, I was also privileged to visit Manitoba and the Northwest Territories in 1970 and British Columbia the following year to mark the centennial of their respective entries into Confederation. It's hard to believe they have now just marked their 150th anniversaries. I also very much enjoyed attending the Royal Agricultural Winter Fair in Toronto twice, which I note celebrates its 100th anniversary next year as well. More recently, I've been celebrating Canada Day in St. John's, Newfoundland. My visits have given me a deep appreciation of the beauty of Canada and the diversity of its people. I undoubtedly share with all of you an appreciation for how such journeys help us better understand our relationships to other people and places. At this time in the planet's history, the work of geographical organizations like yours and the important work it does in geographic literacy, advancing exploration and redefining discovery, and in storytelling through its incredible Canadian Geographic brand, are essential to helping citizens around the world appreciate how geography influences our lives. I feel privileged to be part of the Society's College of Fellows and in its mission to making Canada better known to Canadians and the world.
Thank you, Your Royal Highness. We feel incredibly privileged to have had you join the show tonight. The title of Honorary President has seldom been granted since the Society was founded in 1929. As a rule, it is conferred only upon individuals who best personify the Society's ideals. Past Honorary Presidents include the explorer Joseph Bertrand and former Governor General Vincent Massey. Most recently, the late Alex Trebek nobly served as the Society's Honorary President from May 2016 until his death last year. Just 2 weeks ago, the Society very proudly introduced its new Honorary President, former National Chief of the Assembly of First Nations, Perry Bellegarde. Perry has dedicated his life to championing the rights and well-being of First Nations, and for nearly 40 years, he has held a variety of leadership roles, passionately advocating a vision of peace and friendship that was at the core of the original treaty relationship with Canada, and that is key to building a better and brighter future for our country. As a Royal Society, we understand the history and significance of treaty and related obligations, and we serve as witnesses to this immutable relationship. A member of the Little Black Bear First Nation, Mr. Bellegarde credits the knowledge imparted to him by First Nations elders of Saskatchewan for instilling his deep sense of pride for culture and his belief in Indigenous wisdom and values as critical to fostering a more just and inclusive world. He has championed this vision throughout his career, and we are eminently grateful that he will do likewise as Honorary President, bringing his great leadership and wisdom to the work of the Society in the realm of geographic literacy. It is an immense honor to welcome Perry Bellegarde to the Fellows Show.
Kakia no teintek no ako magnak, ne nashkamun, ke ne nashkum tenoa. Ogimal pieishu awase sega seo, Cuscatel muskusis or skinaganotinia. My friends, my relatives, just a little bit in Cree, I said I'm very happy to be here, and I greeted you all in a humble, respectful way. And I also introduced myself in one of my spirit names, King Thunderbird Child. And I also said I'm from Little Black Bear First Nations, Treaty 4 territory in southern Saskatchewan. Again, I'm happy to be with you all tonight. I want to acknowledge John Geiger, President and CEO of the Royal Canadian Geographical Society of Canada, and the board. They bestowed on me a huge honor. I'm their honorary president for this great institution. And tonight, as fellows and as human beings, I want to talk about the importance of embracing an Indigenous worldview, First Nations worldview. And many of you will wonder and question, well, what is that? And it's simple. It's this relationship we have with the land, to Mother Earth. We acknowledge that every day. Our relationship to Father Sky, our relationship with Grandmother Moon and Grandfather Sun, our relatives, the Star People, our relationship to the four-legged ones, the flyers, the swimmers, the ones that crawl, and our relationship to the grandmothers that protect the waters, the rainwater, the fresh water, the salt water, and when life comes, water breaks. We are the two-leggeds, and we are part of the human race, and we're part of that family, that global family. And the biggest challenge we have now, not only in Canada, but throughout the world, is dealing with this thing called climate change. And we see the declining biodiversity, the rapid increase of plastics amongst our environment, even amongst us ourselves as human beings. And we have to deal with that. If we can embrace our worldview of how we're all connected to the land and water, our challenge is now is to work together, embrace that worldview, so we can create a better Canada, not only for us, but those children yet unborn. And by doing that, we'll create a better world for all of us together.
Wow, how incredible to have been joined tonight by Her Royal Highness Queen Elizabeth's only daughter. What a special moment. Thank you, Princess. And thank you, John. An unforgettable evening indeed. So to help us celebrate, I'd like to encourage all of you to share your photos on social media to show us how you're enjoying in tonight's fun. Je vous encourage à partager vos photos de ce soir sur les réseaux sociaux et ainsi montrer comment vous profitez de cette soirée. You can tag us on Twitter and Instagram and use the hashtag Fellowshow21. It is also important to note that evenings like this would not be possible without the generosity and commitment of many key partners. Our society is fortunate to have a strong and diverse group of corporate partners, many of whom have been active in their support of tonight's show. Here is a quick clip to acknowledge those who have helped make this evening possible.
We would like to specifically thank our presenting sponsor, KCK Global Limited, for their continued support and partnership. Thank you for helping us to achieve our goal of making Canada better known to Canadians and to the world. We are proud and thankful for our relationship with St. Joseph Print Group, BMR Group, and Brown Trout Publishers, all of whom are sponsoring tonight's show. We are also pleased to acknowledge our travel partners, Maple Leaf Adventures and Exodus Travels, and our travel donors, including Anchor D Guiding and Outfitting, Banff Trail Riders, Nahanni River Adventures, OWL Rafting, Rocky Mountaineer, and Viking. Thank you. Now, as part of tonight's event, we are running an online silent auction. All money raised this evening will support vital society programming, such as providing free geographic learning resources to more than 26,000 of Canadian Geographic education, allowing world-renowned explorers to embark on and share videos, photographs, and stories from their incredible expeditions, funding crucial Canadian Geographic research, and bringing Canadian geography to more than 4 million enthusiasts a month through Canadian Geographic's platforms. To bid on items in our online auction, please visit www.rcgsauction.ca. You can scroll through the site to view all of the amazing items available until Sunday, November 21st at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. When you find an item you'd like to bid on, simply register with your email address and a password, then begin bidding. This year, we have dozens of very exclusive auction items, including extraordinary travel opportunities, art, and one-of-a-kind experiences, such as a kayaking trip on the historic Rideau Canal with the Society's inaugural Explorer-in-Residence Jill Hyneth, and a one-year membership to and a private tour of the Royal Botanical Gardens in Burlington, Ontario. please take time to scroll through our auction items and make some bids. In just a moment, we'll be joined by Society Westaway Explorer-in-Residence Adam Schultz and Explorer-in-Residence Ray Zahab from our headquarters in Ottawa.
Thank you, Aliya. It's great to be part of this year's fellow show here at Canada's Centre for Geography and Exploration in Ottawa. I was honoured to be named an Explorer-in-Residence in 2018, and it has been a joy to welcome additional explorers to the program over the years. The exploration experience of our team just keeps getting stronger and more diverse.
That's true, Adam, though we also have many shared passions as well. Even though my expedition style is different than yours, like you, I have a passion for Canada's far north. I'm just not going to paddle clear across it like you. Indeed, I'm stoked about my next expedition, which will take me to Ellesmere Island. We're shooting a documentary of the journey, and I cannot wait to share it with everyone.
Yes, those who know me, Ray, know that Canada's north has a special place in my heart, having traced our portion of the Arctic Circle solo in 2017 for my book, Beyond the Trees. The north also figures prominently in my latest book, The Whisper on the Night Wind.
Of course, Adam, the Arctic is a fascinating ecosystem that everyone should really know more about. And so I'm very excited tonight to have been able to join you to introduce the newest member of the Society's Explorer in Residence program, Arctic researcher Emily Choi.
Emily, we're so very glad that you're now part of our team, and we are looking forward to learning from your expertise in studying the impact of climate change on wildlife in the north. We'd like to present you with the Society's Compass Rose flag to carry with you on your future expeditions.
Thank you very much, Adam. It is a real honor to be named an Explorer in Residence. I have had the privilege to work in many remote locations across the Canadian North, from studying seabirds on the cliffs of Coates Island to working with Inuit communities in the Nuvialuit Sediment region of the Northwest Territories to study the Beaufort Sea beluga population. The Arctic is changing at such a rapid rate, and it is an early warning system for the impacts of climate change across the world. Through my position, I hope to inspire the next generation of youth to study the Arctic and the impacts of climate change. I also hope to share my experience working with the communities in the north who are heavily impacted by climate change. Finally, I hope to use my position to support my research on the impacts of climate change on Arctic marine predators, such as thick-billed murres, an Arctic seabird, on Coates Island in northern Hudson Bay.
Congratulations, Emily. I know the Society is delighted to support your research, and we are so impressed by your curiosity and commitment to working with northern communities. And thank you, Adam and Ray. Now, before we get too much further into the show, I want to remind you to check out our online silent auction at rcgsauction.ca. There are some amazing items up for grabs, including exclusive artworks by Society Fellow RFM McInnes, Corey Trepanier, and Robert Bateman. While you are bidding, please allow me to introduce Society Fellow and Governor, Lieutenant Colonel Carl Gauthier of the Canadian Armed Forces, followed by Society President Gavin Fitch.
Merci, Aliya. I've had the honor for many years now of being involved with the Society's annual medal ceremony. Chaque année, la Société reconnaît des individus et des organismes pour leur réalisation dans le champ de la géographie. Des innovateurs de tous les domaines, explorateurs, géographes, chercheurs et inventeurs, artistes et enseignants ont reçu les prestigieuses médailles de la Société depuis la création de sa toute première, la médaille Massé, en 1959. Au cours des années, la Société a honoré des personnalités comme l'anthropologue d'avant-garde Diamond Jennis, l'explorateur de l'Arctique canadien Henry Larson et la célèbre auteure Margaret Atwood parmi beaucoup d'autres sommités canadiennes du champ de la géographie. Unfortunately, due to the COVID-19 pandemic, we were not able to recognize all of our medalists in person this year. However, a number of them provided special messages at our annual general meeting yesterday, and some others will do likewise during our show this evening. Et maintenant, pour présenter les médaillés de la Société géographique royale du Canada de 2021, j'ai le privilège d'accueillir le président de la Société, Gavin Fitch.
Thank you, Carl. As we all know, 2021 was largely an extension of 2020, with lockdowns extending through significant parts of the year across the country. However, as we have neared the end of the year, vaccination rates have increased greatly, and we are seeing a light at the end of the tunnel. And I'm very hopeful we'll all be able to gather again in person next November for the College of Fellows annual dinner. Still, despite the pandemic-inspired challenges of 2020 and 2021, the Society has more than risen to the challenge. The staff team not only seamlessly pivoted its key programs to be conducted remotely, but led by CEO John Geiger, the group also had the best financial results in Society history, based on stellar donation revenues and continuing custom publishing success. My congratulations to our entire team. Now, while they won't receive any medals for their achievement, as you all know, each year the Society does single out individuals and organizations for their outstanding achievements in the field of geography. It is my utmost pleasure to announce the 2021 Society medalists for their incredible contributions to geography and to Canada. Without further ado, please join me in congratulating the following recipients of this year's RCGS honors.
Bonjour, mes amis. Hello, my name is Barbara Sherwood-Lawler of the University of Toronto and Senior Fellow here at Massey College. It's my immense pleasure and honor today to thank the Royal Canadian Geographical Society for this year's Massey Medal. I want to express my thanks to those that nominated our team for this, and in particular to thank the students, the postdocs, collaborators and friends whose work over the years contributed to the research and the discoveries that are honored by the Massey Medal. Thank you.
Bonjour, mon nom est Yvan Bellard, professeur émérite de l'Université Laval. C'est un immense honneur pour moi de recevoir la médaille Massey de la Société géographique royale du Canada. That's a true honor for me to receive this award from the Royal Canadian Geographical Society. Je tiens à remercier mes étudiants et assistants de recherche, as well as my colleagues who are engineers, geographers, computer scientists, doctors, land surveyors, and so on. Ils étaient de l'Université Laval, from UNB, Natural Resources Canada, Defense Canada, l'INSPQ, Hydro-Québec, Transport Québec, and many other organizations. As an engineer in geomatics, I'm very proud to have contributed to improving the quality of the geospatial data infrastructure of our country. Mieux connaître la géographie de notre pays profite à tous les professionnels et à toute la population générale. Alors, merci beaucoup à la Société géographique royale du Canada.
It's a tremendous honor to receive the gold medal from the Royal Canadian Geographical Society. I'm Professor Sara Seager from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where I'm an astrophysicist and planetary scientist. I'd like to thank the RCGS for this great distinction and for recognizing distant worlds as geographical entities. That is, planets orbiting stars other than the sun, we call exoplanets. I'm proud to be Canadian and thrilled to be a part of the Royal Canadian Geographical Society.
Hi. I'm Jenni Sidey-Gibbons, and I'm a Canadian Space Agency astronaut. I'm speaking to you from Mission Control at Johnson Space Center in Houston, Texas, where we just completed a spacewalk to upgrade the solar panels on the International Space Station. You can see our ground support team behind me here. And I am humbled, honored, and really quite surprised to be able to say thank you for giving me the Royal Canadian Geographical Society Gold Medal this year. The Royal Canadian Geographical Society is a society which I'm privileged to be associated with because you two are furthering Canadians' understanding of our planet and just teaching people about Canada. So again, I feel honored to be associated with you, and I grew up reading Canadian Geographic, so this is just extra special for me as someone who grew up exploring Canada in Alberta and British Columbia. So thank you again, and I hope to celebrate with you in person when time allows.
Hi, my name is Maydianne Andrade, I'm a professor of biology here at the University of Toronto Scarborough, and I'm president of the Canadian Black Scientist Network. It is such a thrill to be made an honorary fellow of the Royal Canadian Geographical Society, and I really am honored to be receiving the Lawrence J. Burpee Award for Science Leadership and Outreach. Lawrence J. Burpee was a multidisciplinary scholar. During his career, he was a civil servant, a librarian, a historian, and a writer. Through his curation of the literatures and histories of Canada, he was able to share his knowledge with the public. That spirit of sharing what we know to engage public interests has always been at the center of my own career, and so this award is particularly meaningful to me. I want to thank the Royal Canadian Geographical Society for giving me this award and for all the work they do to make sure that all Canadians appreciate and love this land.
I'm surprised and thrilled to be awarded the Sir Christopher Ondaatje Medal for Exploration by the Royal Canadian Geographical Society. I'm also humbled. The list of previous recipients and their achievements is impressive. I'm a proud fellow of the RCGS and a strong believer in the Society's mandate of making our magnificent country better known both to Canadians and to the world. Thank you so much for this honor. I'd also like to thank all of the adventurers and explorers and scientists who have inspired me throughout various phases of my life, and I hope that I can continue that tradition.
Thank you, Gavin, and congratulations to all this year's Society medalists. Medalist or not, this evening, everyone has the chance to be a big winner from tonight's show. If you haven't seen it already, check out the 15-day RCGS Exodus Quest to Morocco with fellow Aliya Jasmine. That's me. Come to Morocco with me. Check out our online silent auction and go bid at rcgsauction.ca. We will have so much fun in Morocco. Now allow me to introduce Society Fellow and Vice Chair of the Fellows Committee, Antoine Normandin.
Tonight's program gives us the opportunity to acknowledge and welcome the distinguished individuals who have been elected into the Society's College of Fellows. Depuis 1929, le Collège des Fellows de la Société Géographique Royale du Canada réunit des chefs de file, décideurs, éducateurs, explorateurs, chercheurs, artistes, militaires et philanthropes qui aiment passionnément le Canada et souhaitent en accroître la prise de conscience et les connaissances géographiques, tant au Canada qu'ailleurs. The College has included such luminaries as Nobel Prize winner Frederick G. Banting, the co-discoverer of insulin, pioneering anthropologist and explorer Diamond Jenness, who for a time lived with the Copper Inuits in the Northwest Territories, and artist A.Y. Jackson, a leading member of the renowned Group of Seven. Les Fellows incarnent les valeurs et principes de la société, la détermination de construire, le courage d'explorer, ainsi que leur passion indéniable pour leur communauté. Ce soir, nous avons l'honneur de souhaiter la bienvenue à 74 nouveaux Fellows. Nous saluons tout le mérite qui vous revient par cette élection au Collège et nous vous applaudissons, vous ainsi que les membres actuels. Vous jouez un rôle essentiel afin d'accomplir la mission de la Société qui est de mieux faire connaître le Canada aux Canadiens et au monde entier. Félicitations à vous tous.
Thank you, Norman, and welcome to all new members of the College of Fellows. I was incredibly delighted and proud to join this distinguished group last year and have very much enjoyed sharing my RCGS journey with my audiences. And given my work in broadcasting, I was also very excited to see Canadian Geographic create a new position earlier this year for a filmmaker in residence to support the Society's increasing work in video production. It's a pleasure to welcome Canadian Geographic's inaugural filmmaker in residence, Matt LeMay.
Tanshi, hello, bonjour. My name is Matt LeMay and I'm Canadian Geographic's filmmaker in residence. I'm a very proud citizen of the Métis Nation of Ontario and I've been directing and producing documentaries for over a decade, always with a strong focus on reconciliation and the environment. I have recently wrapped production on my very first CanGeo documentary, which explores the culture and resiliency of the Métis people living in Saskatchewan as they move towards self-determination and self-government. Making this documentary was a very powerful experience for me as a filmmaker, and we look forward to sharing this documentary with you in 2022. Documentary filmmaking can be a very powerful tool that can educate, inspire, amplify, and illuminate, often by shining a light into the darkest corners of our shared history. This is the case for Returning Home, Can Geo Films' debut feature-length documentary, directed by the brilliant Sean Stiller.
Thanks very much, Matt. It's a great honor to be a part of the Fellows Show this evening. For those of you who don't know, my name is Sean Stiller. I'm the director of Returning Home, which is the first feature-length documentary produced by Canadian Geographic Films. When we finally hit picture lock on this film, I don't think any of us really knew what kind of life that this film would have out in the world. And so it's been a pretty incredible past few months. We've just completed, hopefully, our first leg of a film festival run out west. Andrew Lovesey and I were in Vancouver not long ago for the in-person premiere at the Vancouver International Film Festival, where we received not just an official selection, but also Best Feature Canadian Documentary, also at the Calgary and Edmonton International Film Festivals. You know, as a filmmaker, this has been just an absolutely incredible experience. But also as a Tsleil-Waututh person, you know, my desire was always to do the best I could to amplify the story and the work of Phyllis Webstadt, which I consider to be sacred work for this country. So I'd like to thank Canadian Geographic for being such a strong supporter of this film and the vision of the film, and I think also sharing a desire to amplify Phyllis's message. So I hope all of you have the opportunity to watch the film, and in the meantime, I hope you enjoy the trailer. Thanks, Jim.
The majority of the people here in Williams Lake had no idea what was going on in their backyard. The impacts of this St. Joseph's Residential School has been felt from generation to generation to generation, ever since 1891.
I went to St. Joseph's when I had just turned 6. We got stripped. We got put in, I don't know what we got put in, but my orange shirt was taken away. So I wear it today as a symbol of the healing that's taking place.
Something that comes with the Western society and the settlers that arrive here is a fairly stark binary between human and non-human. Humans are the subjects of property, have the capacity to be owners, and everything else is available to be owned.
The salmon is the link between the both the spawning grounds and the open ocean, and also provides the link between the families. Residential schools were set up to break the cycle of the family as a unit of socializing, educating, protecting.
The tradition of the Orange T-shirt Day grew out of Phyllis Webstadt's personal story and reflections on being a residential school survivor, and it's now used as a day to honor residential school survivors.
We've thrived as Tsleil-Waututh people due to the salmon in a lot of ways.
Our people have been fishing here forever. I mean, we've lived here for thousands of years. You get to know a place so intimately.
Merci, Matt. Very much looking forward to your forthcoming documentary chronicling the history, struggle, and resilience of the Métis of Saskatchewan on their journey to self-determination. And congratulations to Returning Home director Sean Stiller and everyone else involved in that production. The film is amazing and it has numerous festival awards to prove it. Of course, society projects like these and all the society's phenomenal programs are largely made possible by the generous support of our partners and donors. You can make a donation anytime. Now's good though, at rcgs.org/donate. Now please welcome Society Fellow and Governor André Préfontaine, whose special message will be followed by messages from another group of individuals honored this evening with Society Medals. Voici maintenant André Préfontaine, Fellow et Gouverneur.
One of the first things I noticed when I started working with Gilles was the high level of energy he brought to just about everything he did. Whenever we were developing a project, launching an initiative, or building a new partnership, Gilles' eyes just lit up. His hands started moving, and you could sense his excitement building. Those in the room with him fed off this energy. His enthusiasm and passion were contagious. Everyone claimed this or that idea as their own, and they made it their personal stake on which they would deliver. Over the years, Gilles had many impressive successes and accomplishments. But in spite of the accolades, Gilles never claimed a single one as his own. Au fil des années, Gilles a connu plusieurs succès impressionnants. Mais malgré les accolades, Gilles n'a jamais réclamé le crédit pour aucun d'entre eux. Rien de tout cela ne se serait produit sans lui, mais Gilles préférait en accorder le mérite aux personnes qui l'entouraient, pas à lui-même. For several years, I had the good fortune of regularly sharing an hour-long commute to the office with Gilles after we moved to a house we had been renovating along the St. Lawrence River, just a few kilometers away from Cornwall. You would think that, given all the time spent in the car with him, I would have come to know Gilles very well. But when I look back, I realize that although we became good friends, I can't say that I knew him that deeply. Granted, Gilles was somewhat reserved, a little private even, but that's not the reason. The truth is, and I see it quite clearly, for Gilles, it was never about himself. He placed others at the center of his universe, and that was what mattered most to him. Nancy, sa famille, ses amis, les personnes avec lesquelles il travaillait avaient beaucoup plus d'importance pour Gilles que ce qu'il ne s'en accordait à lui-même. Ils étaient au cœur de ses pensées, de ses espoirs et de ses rêves. Of course, the conversation often turned to the Society and Canadian Geographic, the projects we worked on, and the people we worked with. And it was when Gilles talked about his staff that his true nature came shining through. So often when talking about one person or another, he would highlight their qualities, emphasize the strength that he perceived in them, and explain how he would work with them to leverage those individual qualities and develop their strength. Not once did I hear him talk negatively about someone. Gilles only saw what was good in the people around him, and he had that rare ability to constantly bring it out in them. I'm grateful for the part of Gilles' journey that I shared with him, and for the many things I learned during that time. Funny, but in a way, Gilles made me a better person. Thank you, Gilles.
Congratulations again to all of our medalists. Félicitations à nos médaillés.
Good evening. In the spirit of reconciliation, I acknowledge that my students and I live, work, and play on the traditional territories of the Blackfoot Confederacy in the Treaty 7 region of Southern Alberta. I want to say thank you to the Royal Canadian Geographical Society and Canadian Geographic Education for this incredible honor. I'm most humbled to receive this award, now named the Gilles Gagné Medal for Innovation in Geographic Education. Gilles' enthusiasm and support for geographic education in Canada has increased geographic awareness and provided opportunities for educational research in my own classroom. I also want to thank Dr. Lynn Moorman from Mount Royal University for her mentorship and enthusiastic work with me and my students over the years. I appreciate all the teachers across Canada who work to bring the importance of learning about our place on this incredible land that we call home. Again, thank you. I'm most honored.
Hello, I'm Alison Gill. I'm Professor Emerita in the Department of Geography at Simon Fraser University. I'm delighted to be honored with a Council Medal this year. After serving as president of the Canadian Association of Geographers, I became involved in the RCGS activities and served as a term on the board. and over the last 16 years have been on numerous committees. Becoming aware of the impressive accomplishments and activities of society members has reaffirmed my passion and belief in the value of geography, not only as an academic discipline, but also in the broader context of Canadians' lives and environments. So thank you to my nominators and RCGS.
Hello, my name is Susan Taylor. I am delighted and humbled to be receiving the Charles Council Award. Delighted because this, in fact, is the first medal that I designed and sculpted for the Royal Canadian Geographical Society over 20 years ago. This marks the beginning of a wonderfully creative relationship with the Society as an artist and sculptor. Also, at the same time, I am humbled to be honored in this way. Thank you.
Hello, bonjour, bijou. My name is Randy Wilkie. I am a geography teacher. I am humbled and honored to be the recipient of the Alec Trebek Medal for Geographic Literacy. I appreciate Mr. Trebek's efforts to promote geography and Canadian Geographic. Like Alec Trebek, I spread a passion for geography. I bring Canada, Canadians, and the world to my students in the hopes of making the world a better place. I want to thank the Phyllis Arnold Endowment Fund for contributing to geographic literacy. To Ian Geddes, Ian McRae, Brian and Matt Popwich, the Ontario Association for Geographic and Environmental Education, and current former students like Maha Firar that played a part in making this nomination a reality. To my beloved wife, Catherine, my children, Kyle, Megan, and my grandchildren, Maya, Nolan, Miles, Dylan, and Louis, whose love and support mean the world to me. Thank you. Merci. Megwich.
This is Gurdeep and they're speaking from the wilderness of the Yukon. I'm feeling very honored to receive 2021 Louis Kemukak Medal from Royal Canadian Geographical Society. Thank you so much. I'm feeling honored that the society recognized my work, which I've been doing to spread joy, hope, and positivity since the beginning of pandemic across Canada and beyond. Thank you very much.
Hello, my name is Trevor Bell. Welcome, geographers, to the community of Arviat, the gateway to Nunavut, and also very close to the Geographical Centre of Canada. I'm honored to be the recipient of the Martin Bergman Medal for Excellence in Arctic Leadership for 2021. I'd like to thank my nominators for their support and generosity, and I'd also like to thank the Royal Canadian Geographical Society for honoring the life of Marty Bergman, who was so passionate about networking and also knowledge to action. Most of my work is at the community level. I'm grateful to Inuit communities for their knowledge and support, and many of the initiatives I have started would not, like Smart Ice, would not have been successful without them. This award recognizes those mentors and communities, and I gratefully accept it on their behalf too. Thank you.
Merci, André. Gilles will certainly be deeply missed. He was an amazing organizational leader, a dear friend to many, and an incredible mentor. Of course, Gilles would be honored to have this award in his name and to congratulate its first recipient and all of the 2021 Society medalists. Gilles was also a big music fan, and before his death, he'd been involved in discussions about our next guest. He was very excited about her participation in our show tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, it is an honor to introduce Society Fellow, five-time Juno Award winner, Order of Canada member, and the classical guitarist known as the First Lady of the Guitar, Liona Boyd.
Good evening, everyone. Bonsoir. Poitiers. I'm Liona Boyd, and I'm honored to be a fellow of the Royal Canadian Geographical Society. I'm sorry that in the past my busy schedule prevented me from attending the College of Fellows dinner to celebrate the great work you do, but I wanted to share remotely my enthusiasm for the Society's very worthwhile projects. And I really hope that next year I'll be able to meet everyone in person. Wouldn't that be great? As many of you know, in the course of my career, I have played every major city across Canada, several times actually, and also some very remote areas from Flin Flon to Yellowknife to Whitehorse to Grand Bank, the Tar Sands, Fort McMurray, and Moose Factory. I actually paddled a canoe for 2 weeks up the Missinaibie River with my guitar in the canoe and played a concert for the Cree people. It was a very memorable and wonderful experience. I'm proud of a piece that I wrote called My Land of Hiawatha. It's in three movements: Spirit of the Moving Waters, Spirit of the Forest, and Spirit of the West Wind. I love to play it all over the world. Also, I wrote a Canadian anthemic piece called Canada, My Canada, another one called Silver Birch, describing the North, where I sing a little bit in Ojibwe, and Aurora Borealis, where I actually went to the Native Center in Toronto and learned some phrases in Cree. And that was part of a TV Christmas special that was shown on PBS and also CBC Gem. This is a brand new video. It's one that was just released, and it's not classical at all, but I had great fun. Some of you will remember in 1972, it was a big disco hit, Popcorn. Mine's called Popcorn Remix. I filmed some of it in Toronto in a funky kind of art studio wearing bell bottoms. And some of it I filmed in Palm Beach, which is my winter home. Also little clips from Mexico and from Venice and from Los Angeles. And they even incorporated some of my father's art, some of his oil paintings, and some of mine, or one of mine, I think, at the very end. Anyway, I had a load of fun both recording the piece and also making the video. So I hope you'll enjoy it. And thank you again for inviting me to be part of your very special evening. Sending you lots of love. Thank you.
Thank you, Liona. What an incredible treat to have you join us this evening. That video was so beautiful. Next up is an amazingly inspiring group of women, all fellows of the Society, discussing the contributions made by women in science. Here are highlights from the chat with astronaut Jenni Sidey-Gibbons, astronomer Sara Seager, and ecologist Maydianne Andrade, moderated by renowned science journalist Alanna Mitchell.
Thank you, Aliya, and thank you so much to our guests here this evening for carving out this time in your schedules to be here tonight. I feel really honored to be in your presence. And, you know, sitting here with you, I'm reminded of just how big a tent geography is, encompassing the work of an astronaut, an astrophysicist, and an evolutionary biologist. You know, I think of geography at its most basic as a manifestation of the human capacity to dream. And all three of you do that in extraordinarily creative ways, showing the rest of us how the world works. Thank you. Science ties the three of you together, of course, and so does curiosity. Each of you has experienced the joy of finding things out and the need to overcome barriers in order to do that. There's a message in that for the rest of us, and it's that message that I want to explore with you this evening. So I thought we'd start with you, Dr. Jenni Sidey-Gibbons. You are an astronaut at the Canadian Space Agency. You studied and taught at Cambridge University in the UK. So here's my question to you. What is RoboGals?
Well, thank you, first of all, for having me as a part of this panel with these wonderful participants. I'm very excited just to be here and to see what everyone has to say. It's a joy to be able to work with Canadians and just be a part of this event. So first of all, thank you. And second of all, to get to your question, RoboGals. So I'm thinking that another thing that people have in common on this panel is probably a passion for education and for sharing STEM, science, engineering, with groups which might not necessarily be exposed to it through the reputation that those types of fields and careers have. So RoboGals was a group that I was involved with when I was at the University of Cambridge, both through my PhD and then later on when I started to work there, that aimed to expose boys and girls, but really get a lot of involvement from girls in robotics. And we were very, very careful with how we led those sessions, that we had a lot of women leading and teaching those sessions so that people would understand and realize that engineering and technology professions, something like robotics, which might conventionally be dominated by one group of people, really was for everybody. So it was just one of the many, many groups that is striving for a more equal representation in engineering. And that's what RoboGirls was about.
Yeah. So why do we need this?
I think we need this because, it's no secret that we benefit most from solving problems with a diverse group of people. So if you only have one viewpoint in the room when you're trying to solve a problem, you're probably only going to try and solve the problem in one way. I mean, when you only have a hammer, every problem is a nail, right? So it's not necessarily the best way going forward. It's certainly not the most creative way to approach a problem the same way every time. That's explaining it at its most simplistic, that we just need different minds and different voices addressing the problems that we're faced with today, because these problems are complex and they affect everybody. So why shouldn't we have everybody in the room trying to solve the problem? And from another level, in my own experience as an engineer and a mechanical engineer, I certainly have been in a profession which I believe is misrepresented. Engineering, I don't think, is as cut and dry and purely technical as it's made out to be in a lot of different scenarios and ways it's represented just in public. I think it's a really creative profession. It's about solving problems creatively to improve the lives of people around you. And that's a really diverse profession, and that's a profession which is appealing to a lot of different people. We just don't necessarily do the best job at sharing that information with people who might find that appealing. So I think it's important just to change the conversation around engineering and some other STEM subjects to get more people involved, because we need all of these voices and a wide range of talents and skill sets pushing towards solutions in order to be effective.
Dr. Maydianne Andrade, you have something to say about this too. I think you're not just a scientist, you're also an activist.
I didn't start as an activist, and I didn't start as recognizing how much being Black affected my work and would affect where I saw my career trajectory taking me. Because of course, the flip side of the business case for diversity, that the we need all the voices at the table because there's creativity and talent that we otherwise are missing out on. That's one side. The other side is just justice. I sent my daughter off to university this year, and I thought it was about a month before I had to have the conversation with her about whether she wanted to discuss the possibility of racism with the people who are responsible for some decisions in her life, or whether she just wanted to decide how to deal with it and pick the battle she would choose, right? 1 month, and that's in Canada. Yeah. So the reality of that, the reality of the fact that I know the data, which shows that people who are exposed to certain kinds of stereotypes, that affects how they're taught. It affects what counselors suggest to them to do as they move through the system. It affects where they end up feeling comfortable. It affects whether they stay in the profession once they get there. We need to fix that, both for the selfish reasons and also just because it is a case of justice. We want other people, everyone, to have a chance to move into the types of things that they have interest, capacity, and talent for. And I'll just say, you know, right now the focus is on the intersections of race with things like gender, but I'm also talking about people who are neuroatypical, who have talents that we also sorely need, but have a hard time making it through the system the way we've constructed it. So, I mean, to Dr. Seager's point, I think we do have a system that was made by kind of one kind of person, and that's not just with respect to race and gender, but also with respect to how you think about work, how you think about your outputs, how you think about what's important, and that is to our deficit.
You know, Dr. Seager, one of the things that I guess I have a bit of frustration with here is this is 2021. Like, sometimes I wonder why this is still necessary. Have you thought about that?
Like, yes, of course, and it does seem frustrating, but at the same time, I like to think we've come a long way. Think 200 years ago, if you just want to pick a number, and think of how long our planet has been around, or the human species. So on the one hand, it's distressing, but on the other hand, we could see glass half full, glass half empty. We're all here, and we're all here celebrating science and exploration, and that's fantastic.
Yeah. Do you see it in your own work, that this need for more diversity? Have you noticed that?
I do, because people operate in different ways, mm-hmm. and it's as simple as people being overly aggressive and dismissive. Sometimes I'm one of them, so let's just say I'm hyper aware of that. To just sort of the block day schedule when you need to leave because you've got a sick family member or you have a child or what have you. So I do see that quite a lot, actually. I also see like a continual need for self-empowerment. So there's like the way that we need to change the world and the conversation. But I've also been investing in helping women. My specific one was like with confidence and the imposter syndrome. Mm-hmm. So I think we need help to change things from many different angles, actually. And I think we can do it. I think we're on the right path. And if we all work together and keep the ball rolling, we have to, right? We have no choice but to have confidence that we can make it a better place.
You know, one of the things I've been thinking about too, Dr. Andrade, is your podcast. I understand that you've got this podcast called The New Normal, which has been launched during the pandemic. And I've been doing a lot of thinking, as we all have, about just what has shifted in the public discourse during this pandemic. I mean, there have been a whole bunch of different points of entry into that discussion, but you've done a whole year of podcasts thinking about this, and what's possible now that was not possible before?
Good question. I would say that when we started The New Normal, and it's a creative collaboration with Lisa Lightburn, among other people, we thought of it as sort of a fun way to get people outside their heads while they were trapped in their homes, right? So we would have a lot of different voices. We would pull back the curtain on what it's like to be in your home and be doing professional work, and tell people a little bit of the narratives around the people we interact with every day. And it very quickly shifted to an equity and collective action focus. And I think that was because that's what I saw as, what we all saw as the major change of the past year, being required to engage in collective effort in such a urgent way has changed, I think, how people think about public life. We're a socialist society, so we were always like that to some extent, right? A public safety net, et cetera, et cetera. But this was a whole different level. And then you add to that the racial reckoning, or I should say reckonings of the past year, which even started with people saying, hey, I never noticed that the guys who are working for $2 an hour coming to my door are all brown, even though I live in an all white neighborhood, you know, things like that. So it just sort of, it galvanized this lens. So the conversations, I feel, are much more frank and honest than they ever have been before about public space, about collective action, about where we want our society to move, kind of to what Dr. Sidey-Gibbons was saying. Sidey-Gibbons? Sidey. Sorry, I'm going to say it again. Kind of related to what Dr. Sidey-Gibbons was saying, that and also Dr. Seager, that we are moving in a good direction. And I think we have to be able to visualize where we want to go before we know how to chart our path there. And I think this pandemic, as awful and horrifying as it has been, has made us stop and think about where we actually are heading.
To me, it gets me thinking about how women like you have been inspired. And I'm thinking about Dr. Seager now, if you don't mind. But when I was reading your book, Dr. Seager, which is called The Smallest Lights in the Universe, you talk about being 10 years old and seeing the stars for the first time, really seeing the first time. And it just captured my imagination because I thought, okay, what does a 10-year-old think about, like you think about when she looks to the heavens for the first time and really starts to, like, I could almost, in the book, I could almost feel your imagination being unleashed, you know. And I what was it like to be 10 years old and to think about that for the first time?
It was just amazing. I wish everyone has an experience like that, and maybe you do. It's like seeing something like incredible art or music for the first time, and like never having known about it before. It was just absolutely astonishing. Yeah. But as a 10-year-old, I didn't think about it again. You know, it wasn't like think of the child's mind. You're not sort of thinking about that every day. It was like a wow. And it kind of got filed away for the future. But I think I'm really glad you brought that up, because I think for each of us here, we're here because of some joy, you know, and excitement and desire to explore geographically, right? Whatever that means for us. And we're also trying to navigate the roadblocks along the way. But that joy and excitement is what I'm really glad you brought that up, because that's a key part of being a scientist.
It's somehow it's about passion, almost about love, I think, in a way.
Yeah, and it's still there.
How do you imagine going into space? I mean, it's one thing for us to sort of look at the stars and imagine what's out there, but you might be going. And I'm just, did you think that was something you were going to want to do when you were a kid?
I mean, I definitely had these dreams of exploration when I was very young. I think when Roberta Bondar flew on the shuttle, I was only a couple years old, and I don't remember that. I don't remember that event, but I remember my mom making a really big deal of it, and I actually have a scrapbook. It's in my on the shelf over there in my office right now, that has news clippings from her mission in it. And again, 2 years old, I didn't put that together, right? That was I was just so fortunate to have a parent who just recognized the significance of that. And I wanted to be an astronaut when that happened. I mean, when that mission happened, and that continued. I mean, I became interested in different things. When Roberta Bondar came to speak in Calgary, my mom took me to go see it. But along the way, I wanted to be a geologist for a very long time. I was really, really interested in the geological record, as much as you can be when you're a little kid. I mean, I was just fascinated by our planet. And I certainly had the ambition to be an astronaut, but again, got interested in different types of science. And for me, I ended up being interested in combustion, which I was completely floored by this idea. If we kind of segment science into these different different areas of human knowledge, there's something, let's say mechanics, which we know the equations for and we know how to solve the equations. There are areas of science we don't even know the equations for yet, but then combustion's kind of in this in-between space where we know the equations, but we don't know how to solve them. And even though we've been using combustion for as long as our definition is a species, I mean, fire and language are the two distinguishing features, we say, of humankind, we still don't really know everything that's going on when a candle burns. So I became fascinated by that, but the tenet is the same. I mean, it's exactly what we've been talking about, is just exploration is important. And I think we are fortunate in Canada. I mean, there's a lot that we have, a lot of work that we have to do as Canadians in our country, but also we are fortunate that those opportunities are available for us.
We're doing this whole conversation about women in STEM and geography and experimentation and exploration and immense creativity and the engagement of imagination. I'm just wondering what you want people to know from you tonight.
Science is about the unknown. We're trying to break new ground, and in that way, it is a journey of exploration.
I think I'm echoing a lot of what was said already today. But we are in agreement. I mean, exploration is just for everybody.
So I agree. I mean, the exploration piece is what's so exciting about science. And you can do the same in terms of biology.
Well, I'm just going to say thank you. Thank you to everybody. It's been brilliant to share this time together. And congratulations on becoming fellows of the Royal Canadian Geographical Society, and to all your contributions. Good evening.
Thank you, Jenni, Sarah, Maydianne, and Alanna. Such a compelling discussion. We have just a quartet of exciting guests still to come this evening. Next up, RCGS Honorary Vice President, renowned cultural anthropologist, author, and photographer, the Wade Davis, followed by another special guest.
Hello, it's wonderful to be with you. Wonderful to celebrate this extraordinary new possibility for exploration, the Trebek Initiative. You know, Alex was such a classic Canadian. He was kind, compassionate, curious, an adventurer in his soul. He embodied all that is great about Canada. And he understood that our country counts, and that the vast expanses of our north, the extraordinary cordilleras, the lakes, the rivers, the forests, the First Nations, that all of this wonder of Canada is worthy of exploration as much as any other part of the world. And his great, in a way, last gift to us was to make possible that a new generation of explorers whose hearts would be fired by his example would have a chance to bring together the energy of these two incredible organizations, the National Geographic Society and, of course, the Royal Canadian Geographical Society, to make possible the unveiling of the wonders of our land. And this is something that will resonate through time, and will be perhaps the greatest memorial to this remarkable man and his greatest legacy to our remarkable country.
Good evening. I am so delighted to be able to join the Society's Fellows show this evening to celebrate the Trebek Initiative. Alex loved Canada, and he was a huge advocate for geographic literacy. He knew it was critical that we learn to understand ourselves and the symbiotic relationship we have with our planet. He believed this understanding would enable us to make prudent decisions and thereby better serve humanity and its environment. The collaboration of the Royal Canadian Geographical Society and the National Geographic Society is truly wonderful, for this initiative is so honoring of Alex's life, as he was an ardent supporter and admirer of both these stellar organizations. So congratulations to this year's Trebek Initiative grant recipients. I wish them all the best on their expeditions, explorations, and endeavors. Thank you so much. Have a beautiful evening. Be safe and be kind.
Ah, springtime. For a bird this size, you see, for this bird, this is, onto this rock formation. Clearly a unique mineral deposit, definitely a sort of rock. Surely with properties the colours are something that we've, oh, he's swimming. Still swimming. And now he's, you know what, I have no idea. I'm sorry, I'm only just the voice. Before I can tell the world, explorers like you need to tell me. And the Trebek Initiative is helping emerging explorers with grants to do just that. By funding future expeditions, they're supporting incredible work that's dedicated to Canada's natural wonders. Now and for the years to come.
Thank you, Wade and Jean, and that ad is so much fun. What a treat to have landed actor Stephen Fry to do the voiceover. He is perfect for that spot. And how incredible is it that the Trebek Initiative has granted more than $360,000 this year to emerging Canadian explorers, scientists, photographers, geographers, and educators. Our next guests, both whom need no introduction, happen to be a pair of famous actors, both of whom have played legendary explorers over the course of their careers. And we're unbelievably honored they could join us here tonight. Please welcome Louis Kamukok Medal winner Jared Harris and the recipient of the Society's Gold Medal, William Shatner. Voici maintenant Jared Harris, récipiendaire de la médaille Louis Kamukok, et William Shatner, récipiendaire de la médaille d'or de la Société.
I can hear you.
You can? You can hear?
No. Oh. I can hear the sound.
Oh. But hang on. Let me turn up the sound then. Where is the sound on this thing? Okay, so my first question. First of all, huge thrill to be talking to you. And I've enjoyed this madcap adventure we've been on for the last 10 minutes.
It is. It's a new one for me. It's a new one for me, too.
You went to space many times in your imagination as James T. Kirk. How did the reality match up?
So I've got this album out now called Bill. It's getting great praise and it's available and all that kind of thing. So it's in release, and the two guys that I wrote it with, Rob the poet and Dan Miller of They Might Be Giants, and I collaborated on this album called Bill. And we even wrote a space song called So Far From the Moon, which has a history. So we sat down on that Sunday before I left for Texas to go in space. And we said, we must write a song about what it's like to be in space. So over dinner, we speculated what it would be like, and we took notes and starting to write a song about me going into space. Boldly Go, we called the song. When I came down to Earth, I called Rob the poet, the lyricist, and I said, stop. Everything we thought it was going to be like is nothing like it was. And we started laughing, and we're going to try again, this time based on the reality of what I went through. So nothing that I expected happened.
I watched the footage of you when you had arrived, and it was very moving. You were very moved by the experience. It seems as though the overriding impression was that the Earth is a very fragile place. Once you get from the perspective of space, would you talk a little bit about that?
Once I read Richard Carlson's Silent Spring 50 years ago or more, I became an advocate an ecological advocate. And in fact, I went on a journey with a famous ecologist. We did a series of films or shows called Voice of the Planet. And Voice of the Planet took me all over with my friend, even to the Himalayas, looking at what was happening to the Earth. Since then, that was several years ago, and I've been talking about global warming and the potential destruction of the planet for many, many years. When I got up there and I looked at the blackness of space, and there's no twirling stars and black holes and things like that, it's just palpable blackness. And I looked down over here to my left and saw the warmth and nurturing of the Earth, I was filled with a sadness that overcame me. And I didn't understand the sadness until maybe hours, certainly days, maybe hours later when I landed. I thought, why am I weeping? And I discovered that when I was able to think about it, Michael Tobias is the name of my friend, the ecologist. So Michael Tobias is a well-known ecologist, and we went and did this 13-week series called Voice of the Planet. Gaia weeping, Gaia crying out for help. The sadness I felt was my knowledge of how much destruction we have done, and how it's possible that we're past the tipping point already. And I've got grandchildren, even have a great grandchild. So my sadness was based on their lives, the lives of all the children coming in front of us, and the fact that we're arguing over how much money to put into the bill of, how much the United States is going to do to help save the planet. And we're arguing about how much, there's no argument. It's like saying about an approaching train. Well, yeah, maybe we should get off the tracks. Well, let's get off the tracks slowly. I mean, it's bizarre. Nobody or very few people understand what's coming our way, the train that's on the tracks of destruction coming our way. We're not filled with the imperative of doing something now, not 30 years from now, as we slowly release our the carbon dioxide and methanes. We got to do it now, and it's the glaciers are melting, and the currents in the ocean, basic things like the currents in the ocean, have the potential of changing because of the cold water. I mean, that one thing after another that scientists know about, that people in general don't know about, and how we have to do something immediately. And that was the cause of my sadness, and I was just overwhelmed.
It was very, very moving. Do you think it comes down to a lack of imagination?
I'm sure what it is human nature doesn't want to deal with unpleasant things. If you can kick it down the, kick the can down the road and let somebody else do it, and it's 4 years here in the United States, for every 4 years somebody else will do it, and we'll do it. I mean, and Canada, although much better about the environment, is still bad. I mean, why? There's been so many things that the Canadian government could have done better in saving the wildlife and the wildlife in the ocean and fish farming and the oil. And I mean, it's just, we all know the problems. The problem is economic, and that's a tough one.
Right.
I'll let somebody else give up their income as against preparing for an inevitable fate. A catastrophe that's coming our way. It's just, so that was the feeling, this generalized feeling of sadness I had as I looked at this beautiful thing, this yellow and blue and white clouds and the beautiful Earth that I've gone around. I had spent a couple of months earlier, I was 60 feet underwater, dealing with tiger sharks, and to hold the beauty of the apex predators and the necessity of them and the millions of sharks we're killing for their fin, for God's sake. I mean, it's just so sad. Yeah. It's sad. It's sad. That's what I was feeling.
Let me ask you a different question then. As an actor, and I'm an actor myself, we all imagine all sorts of phone calls that one will get in one's life with news. Did you ever imagine getting this phone call from, I guess, Jeff Bezos, and how did it come about?
My partner and I, Jason Ehrlich and I, started. Jason had this idea that Blue Origin might be interested in me going up, so he promoted the idea, and they invited us up to Seattle. And we went up to Seattle and talked about, oh, it's a good idea. And then the COVID hit, and about a year later, we hear that Jeff Bezos is going up, and he chooses his brother. And I said to Jason, well, I guess that's it. I mean, it was a good idea, but you know, who's interested? And then Blue Origin said, well, would you guys like to go on the second journey?
Right.
And I thought, well, you know, but I won't go. But maybe, you know, just for the thrill of risking my life, because it seemed to me life risking, although, you know, it's as safe as can be possibly made, but still, you know, they're using hydrogen and oxygen, and I've seen all that footage. But still, the thrill of the experience, risking my life like I had with the sharks, it's not really risking your life, but it is, at least in my mind. So I thought, I'll go for the thrill. Who knew that this incredible amount of publicity would happen, and happen in the right way, in that people were moved by my intuitive response to going up there. I had no idea, and it's still so amazing to me.
Did you have to do any training for it?
Well, we had to do a lot of getting in and out of the seat that we would lie in, in this condition of weightlessness. When weightlessness was over, and as the apogee was reached, and now the vehicle was descending, in about 30 seconds you hit the air, and there will be 5 G's, and you got to get in your seat quickly in weightlessness. So that was a lot of the practicing, was getting yourself strapped into a 5-point harness when you're weightless.
Right.
And then how do you describe weightless when nobody had been weightless there? So that was the problem.
What was the in-flight movie?
The in-flight movie was was a Star Trek.
Yay! Which one? Do you have a favorite?
Star Trek V was the best of them all, I thought.
Okay, there we go. Yes. That's the one you directed, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Is Jeff Bezos a Trekkie?
Jeff Bezos turns out to be a loving human being filled with this grand idea of putting polluting industries up in space. We've put this space vehicle up there. People go and visit it and stay there 6 months and come back and forth. Why not? We have the technology and we have the engines and all that to put up industry up 280 miles up in space, I think it is, and they'd be in geocentric orbit, and they would spread their pollution in space rather than on Earth, like electrical industries burning whatever they're burning up there, and then just sending the energy, the electrical energy, down here. All of this we have the capability of right now to do. And that's his long-term idea.
Okay.
In the meantime, what he's doing is taking baby steps to acquaint you and me, and then the general population, that it's not unusual to get up into space and to work there, and to the advantage of Earth down here.
The Royal Canadian Geographical Society has awarded you the Society's Gold Medal. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Yes. and which is a wonderful honor. I think you're one of, is it now 13 Canadian astronauts?
How wonderful.
Will you talk just a little bit about, I know you already mentioned this, but that was before we solved our technical issues. Would you just talk a little bit about the Society's award and receiving the medal?
Here's my award.
Lovely. Gorgeous.
And I'm very proud of it, and it shall hang on my wall. I've read a lot of books about explorers in the past who've been part of the geological. So I think Lawrence of Arabia was one in England, the Geographical Society there. And yeah. I don't know whether you're related or not, but the word geographical is certainly a relationship. And I'm delighted with this award. It's very meaningful to me, and I mean it when I say that it will hang on a wall. I'm in a room with lots of things hanging around, including individuals I don't recognize. it'll hang somewhere in this room as a very proud accompaniment on the wall.
I just want to say it's been an absolute thrill for me to talk to you, Bill, if I could call you Bill. I'm a huge, huge fan of yours, and I would have loved to have been able to have done this in person, but it is a thrill just being able to chat to you. And by the way, I think we were in a movie together, although we didn't actually work on the same day. It was a film called Baby, 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 by Brian Klugman, and you did a scene with Cloris Leachman, and I was part of a different vignette. But I hope one day that we get to work together, because I'm a big fan and great admirer of you. That
would be wonderful. Thank you very much, gentlemen, in what was difficult circumstances, but we overcame.
We did.
Take care.
Bless you. God bless you.
Thank you, gentlemen, and congratulations, Mr. Shatner, on your gold medal. What a treat it was to have you join us this evening. Before our show winds down tonight, I'd ask that everyone check their online auction bids. It's not too late to show us you care and help support the Society's amazing programs. And our annual auction doesn't end tonight. It's open until Sunday, November 21st at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. So keep checking in and keep bidding. A reminder to everyone who participates in that auction, if you are a winning bidder, you'll receive a notification by text or email on November 22nd with a secure link to make your payment. We will arrange for pickup or delivery of items. And a quick reminder that you can also help the Society maintain its incredible programs by making a donation tonight or anytime at rcgs.org/donate. Thank you to Her Royal Highness Princess Anne, to Leona Boyd, our science panelists, Wade Davis, Jean Trebek, and again to Jared Harris and William Shatner for all joining us tonight. And congratulations again, too, to all of our medal recipients this evening and to all new members of the Society's College of Fellows. Welcome. Thank you to all of our partners, friends, volunteers for helping to make this a truly special evening, and to the RCGS staff who helped pull this magnificent event together. And thank you again to everyone for watching this evening. I look forward to seeing all of you in person in Ottawa next year. Merci encore à tous de votre présence ce soir. J'attends avec impatience de vous revoir en personne à Ottawa l'an prochain. Good night, bonne soirée.